Hello, my name is Kristen Masters. I'm an assistant professor in the Department of Biomedical Engineering here at the UW-Madison. And today I'm going to talk about scientific integrity and research misconduct. So what I'm going to go through today is the definition of scientific integrity. What are some examples of scientific misconduct? Why do people commit scientific misconduct? And what are some ways to avoid committing scientific misconduct? So first, I'm going to read you just a couple definitions of how people define scientific misconduct. And if you'll excuse me, I have to look at my paper because I did not memorize these. So one very universal definition of scientific misconduct is intentional or gross negligence leading to fabrication of the scientific message or a false credit or emphasis given to a scientist. And I think a somewhat complementary definition is fabrication, falsification, plagiarism, or other practices that seriously deviate from those that are commonly accepted within the scientific community for proposing, conducting, or reporting research. And the reason I give you two definitions is because one of them includes the false credit or emphasis given to a scientist, while the other one does not explicitly say that. As opposed to the second one, I think encompasses it is a little bit more general in terms of doing things that deviate from common scientific practice. And it should be noted that neither of these definitions include honest error in scientific research. So I'm going to start with a little bit of a historical perspective on scientific misconduct, because I personally am entertained by some of these examples. And actually surprised by some of them as well. So there are many, many instances over the years of people committing research misconduct. And it spans much farther back than this, but one of the most notable older examples is actually in the 1850s. I'm sure you've all heard of Mendelian genetics, etc. Well, he is accused of actually smoothing his genetics data and omitting a lot of the other data points. Now, that didn't actually affect the validity of his findings. In fact, we base all of our genetics knowledge upon this right now, but it still is scientific misconduct what he did. In the 1960s, a very commonly cited example of scientific misconduct was something called polywater, where some scientists said that they found a polymerized form of water. It turned out that this was just due to unclean glassware, but it was a worldwide phenomenon that was very interesting. And actually, I'll get to this later, but might not exactly fit into scientific misconduct. One of the most entertaining examples, I think, is in the 1970s. A guy named William Summerlin, he blackened white mice with a permanent marker in order to make it look as if skin transplants from black mice had been successful. I thought that was pretty classy. But there are lots more examples over the year. I'm sure for students these days, one of the ones that's been in the news the most has been Woo Suk Wong out of South Korea, the very famous embryonic stem cell researcher, who was found to have fabricated data and falsified data and photos related to his work on embryonic stem cells and cloning. So that's just a little bit of a historical perspective on research misconduct. So now I'm going to give you some more examples of, you know, these were sort of extreme and very notorious examples. So now I'm going to give you some ones that are a little bit more generalized to the type of research that you might be doing in lab. So examples of scientific misconduct are fabrication. So fabrication is sort of the invention of data or photos or whatever you're working with. This is actually different from falsification, which is generally viewed as taking material that you already have and falsifying it, basically, adjusting it, smoothing it. That's not a good idea to do. Plagiarism, so I think that's probably the thing that most people are familiar with, at least students, in terms of being told not to plagiarize, which is copying someone else's work. This includes taking, you know, direct quotes from someone else's work. A variation on plagiarism is actually known as citation plagiarism. And this is actually defined as the willful or negligent failure to appropriately credit the work of others. So in other words, even if you don't copy word for word what someone else has said, if you are citing ideas that someone else has published on, and you are neglecting to cite them, or if you are completely neglecting to cite ideas that are relevant to the work that you're doing at all and intentionally omitting them from a report, that actually can be viewed as scientific misconduct. Self-plagiarism is actually a form of scientific misconduct, although admittedly one of the ones that is most commonly done, and that is, you're plagiarizing your own work. You're taking big chunks from things that are already published and publishing them again. Violation of ethical standards. So this is a little bit different from the categories of scientific misconduct that I've been talking about so far, in that most of those have dealt with the generation and reporting of data. The violation of ethical standards has to do with maybe you did your research and you're reporting true data. You did not fabricate, you didn't falsify anything, but the way that you obtained your data was unethical. So you did not have consent from your subjects, for example. This is a really big deal when doing clinical research. You have to get consent from your patients in order to enroll them in a study. So this would be an example of violating an ethical standard. And lastly, there are many, many other examples of scientific misconduct, but in terms of the major ones, ghostwriting. And ghostwriting is someone writing a paper when they didn't actually do the work, or leaving off authors that did do the work. And I know this sounds completely contrary to what people would normally want done. Normally people want to get on the paper, even if they haven't done the work. But ghostwriting is commonly done when one of the authors has, or one of the people who did the study, has a significant financial interest in the study's success. And so they have what's deemed a conflict of interest, and they don't want to report that, so they just remove their names from the paper. So that, for instance, if a paper came out all about the miraculous effects of some drug and how it cures everything, but the lead authors were all funded by the drug company, they might try to find some other researcher to put their name on it instead, so that it doesn't look like this is just a publication by the drug company. Anyways. Some murkier waters when it comes to scientific misconduct. Unintentional publication of incorrect data. This happens a lot, and honestly, and this isn't really considered scientific misconduct if it truly is unintentional, but honestly, this is how science works a lot of the time, where, you know, our knowledge of things evolves, and it's not always the fault of a researcher if when they publish at the time, this is what's commonly believed and what they have the proof to say right now. And sometimes, you know, improved techniques, etc., leads us to go back to that data and say, well, that's, we have a better way of looking at it now, and this doesn't always work. But in general, that's, depending on who you talk to, it may or may not be scientific misconduct, but I think the general research community feels like that if it is truly unintentional, it's not truly misconduct. Again, falling under that same category, general sloppiness. If it's just, and there are more heated feelings about this one on both sides of the issue, in terms of people think that if you are extremely sloppy, then it is negligence. And also suppression of negative results is another area of murkier waters when it comes to scientific misconduct. So reasons why scientists commit fraud. Scientists are human, and they make mistakes just like anyone else. It might be some sort of malicious motivation, such as standing in the scientific community, wanting to get grants, career pressure. There's some people feel publish or perish pressure there, where, and that means that if, in order to get grants, remain active in the research community, you have to be publishing. And there's also a certain amount of egotism in it sometimes, in that people really believe that they know the right answer. And so they're so convinced that their hypothesis is absolutely correct that they just don't perform any other supportive experiments that could provide other explanations for what they're seeing. The consequences of a scientific fraud have not been very well explored. It's really only in recent years, I'd say probably in the last 5 years, that there have been more clearly defined consequences for committing intentional fraud. There's a big discussion right now about whether it's criminal or not. One researcher recently from Scientific Misconduct committed in 2005 was actually put in jail for a short amount of time. And because it was considered a form of financial fraud by submitting grant applications and getting money from the federal government to perform research, even though the application was based upon entirely fabricated data. Some people are banned from getting federal grants ever again if they have been found guilty of scientific misconduct. But the manner in which the proceedings happen in terms of whether you're guilty or not is not very consistent at the moment. So how can you avoid committing scientific misconduct? I think one of the biggest things that you can do is keep a good lab notebook. I understand that you've already had a lecture on how to keep a good lab notebook, so I won't go over those guidelines again, but just take that advice that was presented in that other lecture because it can become really important. You should also cite your sources all the time. This goes back to the plagiarism part as well, always cite if you've taken a quote from a paper, etc., or even taken any sort of statement from a paper. You need to cite your source. And lastly, there are ethical problem-solving mechanisms that you can do if you see scientific misconduct going on in your lab. Or you're trying to decide whether something that's going on in your own research is ethical or not. I don't really have time to go through it today. I teach entire courses on this. But there are several acronyms available. One of them is called the Disorder Acronym, and you should have a handout on this. And it just basically provides you a nice framework for going through an ethical problem and defining the problem, getting information about it, identifying who are the stakeholders in the situation, so who cares about this, what are the options, so listing out what are all the potential solutions to this. The ethical problems aren't always black and white, and I think many times people jump to the thinking that the two extremes are the only options. And what mechanisms like this are meant to do are to help you identify sort of those middle ground things that are still ethical, yet can help you solve a situation so that in a satisfactory way. So I won't go over the rest of this. I'll leave you to read it since it's fairly self-explanatory. And thank you for listening to my explanation of scientific misconduct, how to identify what scientific misconduct is, and hopefully some ways that you can avoid ever being accused of scientific misconduct.